And finally, a final word from our unforgettable Gwen Ifill. Gwen was interviewed by her close friend and fellow journalist Michele Norris for an episode of the PBS series The History Makers, which first aired in January 2015. We close tonight with Gwen's own thoughts about political history, journalism, and her own role.
When you went to television,
yes,
we heard from Pete Williams that you took to it almost immediately.
That's so not true. I love Pete, and it's so sweet that he thought that, but it was really hard making, and you know this, making the transition from print to television. You had to figure out how to write differently, you had to figure out how to present differently, and you had to settle on the right shade of lipstick, which was huge. It turned out that everybody had something to say about you when you were in front of the television. But the other thing is, you get your phone calls returned. People felt they knew you. That accessibility quotient came to work. And you reached a much broader audience. So when I left the Times, I remember going to the then publisher, Arthur Sulzberg at the Times, and told him I was thinking of leaving to go work for NBC. And he said, why would you go work in television? I don't watch television. Well, that's changed. But the point was, I wanted to make sure another important lesson for the for the children, which is I didn't burn any bridges. I made sure in case I failed in television, I could go back to print. And I didn't fail for the same reasons why you don't fail. You work hard. It's not how you get in the door. It's what you do once you're through the door. And you make sure that you make friends and learn lessons from the people who are willing to help and ignore the
haters.
You
know, one thing that I can say, having worked in television also, is that everywhere I would go, I would find camera crews who loved them some Gwen Ifill. That you remembered that it was a team that got you.
Well,
on
and I would
the
flirt
air.
With the camera crews too, it should be
oh,
said.
Okay. There was that.
To this day.
You covered a lot of conventions.
Yes.
And you've said that covering the conventions is actually one of your favorite parts of covering politics.
Yeah.
What do you love so much about conventions?
I'm one of the last holdouts who think conventions kind of matter. I like a room full of people who are enthusiastic about the process. I think it's important that we hear from the future leaders of our party. I was standing on the podium, the dais, in 2004 when the keynote speaker finished speaking. And when Barack Obama walked over to me with the, you know, place was crazy and the confetti was flying and balloons. And
balloons
there was
and
this
all that.
Electricity, you'll remember that night. And I asked him how he thought he did. He says, I think I did okay. Now, I found out later that Michelle had said to him in advance, just don't screw up. So you know what? He didn't. And it was great to be there in that moment at that time and to talk to him about it and to capture that sparkle that came off him as he was bursting onto the scenes.
Your brother has said that you, as a kid, used to watch conventions.
Yeah, I don't believe everything my brother says, but that's right.
You did. You did.
We watched conventions kind of for recreation. Once again, this was an extension of the fact that my parents thought that what happened in American politics and government mattered. So, and also keep in mind that when we were growing up and watching conventions, we didn't know how they were going to end. They were actually kind of dramatic. Mm-hmm. And imagine watching a convention where Barbara Jordan gets up and speaks. Mm. And you're a little black girl at home who sees nothing like this on television. It blows your mind. Where else was I going to see that voice, hear that voice? And so as a result, whenever I go through the Austin airport, I stop and pat her a little bit. There's a wonderful bronze sculpture of her in baggage claim at the Austin airport. And I just greet her every time because she was amazing. And Shirley Chisholm. I mean, there were women, black women, who were out there speaking their truth in an environment where it wasn't generally welcome.
As I listen to you talk about this, though, I'm imagining children watching television now and seeing you.
Okay. She's going to make me a little verklempt here. You know, when I was a little girl, there was a woman named Melba Tolliver who was on the news, and she had a big afro. And I just was transfixed by this idea. That didn't make me want to be in television as much as it made me want to tell the story. Hmm. And every now and then, I'm not particularly interested in, you know, I just get caught up in whatever the day's work is, and invariably somebody will come up to me and tell me the story of their little girl. And it always stops me in my tracks. Because as long as I remember that there's someone on the other side of the piece of equipment, the camera, who's watching me with expectation, and it can shape what they do next, I have to take what I do seriously every single day.
That's the NewsHour for tonight. To my friend and mentor, thank you, Gwen. I'm Hari Srinivasan.
and on Judy Woodruff. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, Gwen, we love you, we'll miss you, and we know all of you in our audience will too.